to historic Asbury United Methodist Church. There are four congregations called Asbury in this county, and so I refer to us as the Asbury. We are the mothership. We are the oldest African-American congregation in the city and in the county. We date back actually to 1803 when persons first started to gather together to worship our God. The official building date is 1838. So if you know your history, you know what was going on in 1838. Africans in America are not the first diaspora people. Long before we were brought to these shores in chains, our Hebrew brothers and sisters knew what it was to live in exile, wrenched from their homeland, living under oppression. And one of those penned a psalm that we call Psalm 137. And in that he asks the question, how can we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? Our tormentors demanded songs of us. How can we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? You are here this evening because we, Africans in America, diaspora people, had to learn to sing the Lord's song in a foreign land. How does one sing the Lord's song when you are not free to govern yourselves? How does one sing the Lord's song when the white church is in charge because we cannot be trusted? How does one sing the Lord's song when people value you as less than human? But oh, sing we did. And we created songs that were messages, songs of escape, songs of freedom. And we sang and we sang and we sang. And we sang our way all the way to the great stages of the world. And so we're here tonight to hear the fusion of that journey of Africans in America who sang the Lord's song, and we call those spirituals, and Africans in America who claim the heritage of music that is this country. I mean, really, where would music be in this country without black people? Welcome to Asbury. Welcome to our story. Welcome to your story.
Welcome to Arias and Sharpies, a musical tapestry celebrating Black History Month. In the imagination and experience of the American public, there is a wide dichotomy between arias and shanties, or for the purpose of this program, slave songs. To bridge that gap, we want to explore the music and weave together a poignant yet provocative comparison between the aria and the shanty slave song in commemoration of Black History Month. The aria first appeared in the 14th century as simply a manner or style of singing or playing music that told a story, shared an emotion, or presented a monologue. Similarly, unique genre of the slave song style of singing or playing also told a story, shared an emotion, presented a monologue of deep thought, and in many cases shared the slave's resistance to bondage or shared a code for escape. These traditional songs or spirituals are deeply rooted in oral history based on African music and European Christian religion, which is specific to those Africans that were enslaved here in the United States. So these two musical traditions with different composers, conventions, singers, audience, what do they share? Let's be bold and unabashed this afternoon and go on a journey of discovery to find out. Let's begin with the first selection. We'll go to Charles Gounod's opera, Faust. A village celebration is taking place in the public square where the devil makes an appearance. He's not here. He provides a crowd with wine and spirits, sings a crude and irreverent song of mankind's weakness for greed and lust. He finishes by declaring that Satan is behind it all. Wait a minute, Satan? No, Satan? This continues the opera's more elastic, storyline, common theme in the slaves' narrative. Let's listen now as bass baritone Kevin Short, accompanied by Dr. Lester Green, and Kevin is singing the role as Mephistopheles, sings La Vogue d'Or, or Song of the Golden Calf. Let's welcome.
Oh,
now considered a piece of Americana, it remains controversial to this day. Devonta Orr Ogden and Kevin Short, along with Dr. Green, will perform "Bess, You Is My Woman Now." high and low art. Through comedy, absurdity, and beautiful music, this opera within an opera. It also highlights the state of the human condition which employs us to seek love, beauty, and the joy of creating music, which is one of mankind's core gifts worldwide, and allows us to celebrate victory, or to use an African-American phrase, jubilee. Crystal Williams performs Sein Gebet Gut, followed by Hard Trials arranged by Burley, and then performed by Edward Washington, tells us that without the good Lord in your heart, the devil will get sure ain't them hard trials.
Have nests in the air, and everything.
with that Deep River, the widespread success, because Burley had that voice singing Deep River, and made it one of the most beloved spirituals. Though filled with longing for change, the song looks to the possible future than the past. Deep River carries a strong meaning for the enslaved Africans, as the Jordan River in the song symbolized the Ohio River, dividing line between the slave states and the free states. A campground is a type of gathering that served as a vehicle for slaves to commune and share their sorrows and hopes, though illegal in some areas. Again, an aria, perhaps? Kevin?
Into 2002,
to a more contemporary version, somewhat gospel, somewhat jazz. Edward and Crystal will bring Joseph Schubert's arrangement to us.
Thanks and appreciation.
whether it is an intricate aria performed on the opera stage or an intricate Negro spiritual, the music is the universal language that speaks to all of us. Arias and shantis offer us songs that share people's hearts, their soul, their life, their loves. Let us remember as we stand and listen to the national Negro anthem, the J. Roseman Johnson's Lift Every Voice and Sing, arranged by Roland Carter, will be performed by their quartet as they unite us in one and lift us in song. Devante, Kevin, Edward, Crystal, and Dr. Green.